So if we have information about our population data, we want to be able to build this normal distribution that's showing how sample means would behave. So let's talk about some properties, and then we'll get some practice with working if the population's normally distributed versus what we need to do when the population's not normally distributed. So for a sampling distribution of means, as we saw in that previous video in the simulation, we should be getting out this bell-shaped curve. And in order to know we have this bell-shaped curve, we have to check the central limit theorem first. So we'd have to check those properties of independence, randomization, and then make sure that we have a large enough sample size if our data is skewed in any way. But if we check those conditions first, then we know we have this bell-shaped curve. And from there, what we need to know about this curve is where is it centered and what's its standard deviation. So when we go into GeoGebra, those are the two key pieces of information that we need to build our bell-shaped curve. So we talked about how when you take means of means, it's going to reflect that population mean. So if the wording of the problem tells you about a population average, that's what we use for the center of our distribution. And as a reminder, that mu with the x bar is representing the average of sample means, which relates to the center of our distribution here. Then what we need is our standard deviation, and we need to calculate standard deviation. We talked about how it's always going to shrink, and we also talked about how the larger the sample size, the smaller the standard deviation is. So here's our notation for population standard deviation, and this will also have that little subscript of x bar because it's a standard deviation of sample means. So it's that if we have this data, then we're taking the standard deviation of those x bar values. To calculate our standard deviation, you're going to take the population standard deviation and divide by the square root of our sample size. So in the numerator, that's just the original population standard deviation. And then the denominator, you use sample size. And in the denominator is where sample size has an effect. If you can imagine plugging in a small value down there, like, I mean, think of the smallest value, 1. If we divide by 1, we're not really changing that standard deviation at all. In fact, it's not going to shrink at all. If we divide by 2, yeah, divided by a little bit, so standard deviation will be a little smaller. But if we plug in something like a sample size of 1,000, well, if we're taking our original standard deviation and dividing by a really large value, that's going to shrink our standard deviation so much. And it's because when we take large sample sizes, we're getting a lot of accuracy out. So there isn't going to be a lot of variability. So sample size has an effect on our standard deviation. Basically, the larger the sample size, the smaller the standard deviation. So let's go through an example, and with this example, we're going to look through if we know our population is normally distributed, because we approach it a little bit differently than if we know that it's not normally distributed. So a person's measured glucose level 1 hour after ingesting a sugary drink varies according to the normal distribution. So this wording right here, that it varies according to the normal distribution, that is very important because that's telling us that our population is normally distributed. So we know that if we had our population data, we'd have a nice bell-shaped curve. And that with that bell-shaped curve, we'd have this mean and this standard deviation. So we have our information about the population. So in part A, if a single glucose measurement is made, define and draw the distribution. And what's the probability that a single measurement is greater than 140 milligrams per deciliter? So with this, the key piece of information here is that we're just looking at what's happening for a single glucose measurement. So we're actually not using the sampling distribution of means here because we aren't taking a sample, really. We're just looking at how individual values behave. In terms of how individual values behave, that was given right up here according to our population. If we know how every individual behaves, then we can use this distribution that's normally distributed with a mean of 125, standard deviation of 10, and that'll tell us about how single values behave. So what we want to do is to find our probability, we want to use that curve and we want to go to GeoGebra and let's see, we'll have 125 in the middle. We want to find greater than 140. So we want to create this cutoff point wherever 140 is and find the area to the right. So with that, we'll go to GeoGebra to find what's this probability of being over 140 with that mean of 125, standard deviation of 10. So we're at our normal distribution. Get keyboard up. So 125, standard deviation of 10, and we want to find this right-hand side above 140. And that's going to be a 0.0668. So there is a 6.68% chance a single measurement is greater than 140. That throws back to what we talked about when we first saw our normal distribution. Given a mean and standard deviation for a bell-shaped curve, finding probabilities under the curve. Now what we're going to move to is what if we took a sample? If the measurements are made on three different occasions and we collect the mean result of those three occasions, discuss the conditions that we would need, which whenever it asks for the conditions, that's asking to check our central limit theorem. So, central limit theorem, three pieces we need to check each time: independence, randomization, and sample size. So, independence, what we'd think about mentally is just how if we took a random sample of people, their glucose levels don't affect each other. One person's glucose level is independent of the other. So what we need to note is that glucose levels themselves are independent. So we're good there. Randomization, when we grab these three different measurements, it should be a random sample, and it would be nice if they said random somewhere in the wording. But what we're going to assume is if they don't state it, we're just going to assume that it is random. We're going to assume they're good statisticians taking random samples. So we'll go ahead and move on from there. And then sample size. So sample size of 3 is definitely less than 30. So it's small, but we know we have a normal distribution. So while n equals 3 is small, population is normal. And if that population is normal, then we don't need to worry about taking a large enough sample size. We know it's going to come out bell-shaped anyway, no matter what sample size we take. So once we pass those three conditions, what this tells us is that, okay, when we find this distribution of means, it's going to be bell-shaped. But if we fail any of those conditions, if it's obviously not independent or obviously not random, or the sample size isn't working, then we can't move forward because we don't have a bell-shaped curve. So with that, what we want to do is this idea of taking a sample of 3, given that we assume we're going to have this mean and standard deviation coming through from our population, what is our distribution going to look like? So if we go back to our notation up above here, the key is that if you're finding a distribution of means, if we pass the central limit theorem, we know it's normal, so we'll have our notation for n. For the center of the distribution, you just use your population mean. And then for the standard deviation, we have to do a little calculation of taking the standard deviation divided by square root of our sample size. So for us building this distribution here, the mean for our distribution of means is just going to be the population mean. So we just have to copy down that 125. For standard deviation, we'll take our old standard deviations, that population standard deviation of 10, and divide by the square root of our sample size, which is 3. That's going to give us a 5.7735. So we're going to have here is this normal distribution centered at 125, standard deviation of 5.7735. And with that, we can throw it into GeoGebra to get a visual of how things distribute. I mean, we have our old distribution in here, and the only thing that's going to change is our standard deviation, which we'll just type in 5.7735. A little tip with GeoGebra: if you're ever trying to type in and you get stuck at this third decimal place, and it is important to have 4 decimal places in here, it can change the answers a little bit. If you use this keyboard that's actually within GeoGebra that pops up, if you type in with this, it'll take all the values. I think it's something with the formatting of GeoGebra and being tablet friendly. So if you get stuck trying to type in with a keyboard at that third spot with standard deviation, if you go to this keyboard and type in, it'll take all of it. Little quirk with GeoGebra there. So once we get that filled in, we can see our distribution change. We still expect 125, but now our values are much closer to 125 because now this is a distribution of averages. So if we took a sample size of 3 from our population, how would the averages behave? So if we go to our next question of what's the probability that the mean of 3 measurements is greater than or equal to 140, well, notation-wise, this sounds very similar to what we were doing before, in that we're going to our distribution centered at 125, and we're going to look at the probability of being above 140. So really, in terms of a picture, I didn't change much, mostly because I didn't create a scale that matched up with the standard deviation. But with the wording of the problem, I know I need to use this new distribution of means. And the key wording you want to look for with these, in terms of are you using a distribution of means or just the population distribution, is that we're looking for the probability of a mean. Before it was just the probability of a single measurement, but now if we're finding a probability of means, you have to use this distribution of means. So we need that adjusted standard deviation to say this is how averages from a sample size of 3 would behave. So in GeoGebra, we set that up more than 140, and that's a 0.0047. As you can see, this probability is much lower than what we saw in part A. It's because 140 was far away from 125 already, but in terms of single measurements, 140 was fairly close by because with single measurements, you can have more variability. But as soon as we start taking averages, we expect to be much closer to 125. So 140 moved way out here in the tail. Because it's so far above, it would be much more difficult to get an average of 3 people getting that 140 out. So probabilities can tend to decrease with these. In fact, with some questions, you might be getting probability of 0 out a lot, just because you have to be very close to that expected value in order to get probabilities coming through. So, probability of being more than or equal to 140 was the 0.0047. So with this, there's a 0.47% chance that the mean of 3 measurements is greater than or equal to 140. So with this in your wording, the word mean should show up somewhere. It should have mean attached to a sample size as well. It's like the mean of 3, the mean of 25. That sample size is important because if we change the sample size, the probabilities change as well, because it's going to change our calculation for that standard deviation. Then what's the 95th percentile for the average of 3 results from this person? So what we want to do is take this distribution, and 95th percentile, remember, is the area to the left. So we're going to have this cutoff such that there's 95% of our data to the left-hand side, and we want to find what that value is. And while that's x, it's technically x bar, like we're finding this sample mean because they threw in that word average of 3. So because that average of 3, we need to use that distribution again with our new standard deviation to show that it's a distribution of averages. So in GeoGebra, we have our distribution. We're going to set the area to the left, and we need to adjust the area to 0.95. And that's going to give us a cutoff of 134.4966. So if we take P of X less than or equal to 134.4966, that would give us this area of 0.95. So the cutoff for the 95th percentile is, let's say, about 134.5 milligrams per deciliter. So this is what we need to do for finding probabilities of means. We need to create the sampling distribution of means. We need to check our central limit theorem first to make sure we have a bell-shaped curve. But it's just the same work of finding probabilities within GeoGebra. It's just you need to pay attention to sample size and how that affects your standard deviation.